Okay, good morning all. And I want to do some sort of shifting from all the academic and scientific and engineering lectures that were given in the day before and today, and talk about the process of decision making regarding ammonia in Israel during, let's say, the 3 or 4 decades. So let's start with what I'm going to talk about. I'm going to bring some historical overviews. I'm sorry about all those. Where should I stand? Here is better? Yes. Talk about what happens when there was an attempt to do a very comprehensive QRA in regarding also ammonia plants in Israel, in Haifa Bay. Talk about risk management responsibility, who is going to do this risk management responsibility, about mechanical integrity and how important it is in ammonia. And you also heard the previous lecture that talked about, that talked a lot about mechanical issues. And then most of the lecture, I'm going to talk about separation distances and how they cause what we call, what I call, the unavoidable conflicts. I think that the first time that a report regarding ammonia was not using the Pasquill Gifford Turner was in 1982. It is made by Ilan Setter from, I think that the Israel Forecast Institute, Weather Forecast Institute, and he used it, the first one that used non-Pasquill Gifford Turner simple Gaussian model to compare two options of storing ammonia in a pressurized vessel, in ambient temperature and high pressure, or in atmospheric a tank in more or less near the boiling point. Later on, in 1996, there was, I think, that the first time that the Israeli government has ordered risk assessment made by TNO. I'm going to talk about it a little more. And then you can see that in the beginning of the millennium, there was an attempt to make a risk management program, much like the one that is does in the United States, the EPA RMP. And in 2011, the Ministry of Environmental Protection published the separation distance guideline that sets how what should be the distance between hazardous sites or processes containing hazardous substances and public receptors. So as I said, I already said it, SETA was the first one that used non-PGT models, but and that time in the 80s, only the Ministry of Defense and in particular the Civil Defense Forces use some sort of a way to estimate the distances between or the impact of incidents of hazardous substances. They use some sort of a ruler, not even a computer program, a ruler that you can took the substance like ammonia, pick the right atmospheric condition and get a distance for, you can see here, with a pointer that as an endpoint, they use the LC50 or LD50 data. So it was, the only concern was lethality. Later on, the government, I think that there was a, yeah, it was still them, and I think that I don't remember when the Ministry of Environmental Protection was erected. But I think that it was one of his first initiations, where to hire TNO, that a very famous company located in the Netherlands, that mainly in the Netherlands, that were behind the QRA done in the Netherlands, and they asked them to do the same procedure as done in the Netherlands, to investigate what are the risks and the integrated risks in Haifa Bay. It was the first time that a report in Israel showed what is called the individual risk, which is the chance of a hypothetical individual to get killed due to an incident in a chemical plant. And they draw around the plants and all hazardous facilities in the Haifa Bay, all these contours of 10 to the minus 5 and 10 to the minus 6 chances per year. This is the annual chance of fatality. And I think that was the most problematic issue. They used the Dutch Effen curve to represent the societal risk, which is, let's say, in addition to the individual risk, you also, in a QRA, put some sort of a criterion to protect against a massive disaster. So it's not just the chance, but also the quantity or the number of people that might be killed, and that is taken into account in the societal risk criteria. Death and curves are were used by TNO. Following the report showed that there were some, let's say, minor risks that were inapplicable according to these criteria that they used in the Haifa Bay. All of them were fixed almost immediately. It was not really a big issue. But that was not what happened later. What happened with that report, that any change that had to be made in Haifa Bay had to be done, had to go through all this sort of risk assessment, because if you do one thing, then you change probably the integrative risk assessment. So it was not just that it was very expensive to do this risk assessment, because then any plant had to hire either TNO or Arthur D. Little or any other famous company that were that got a license or a permit from Haifa municipality to do these risk assessments. But that was also not the issue, but the main issue was that nobody really understood what it meant. Maybe the IR, the individual risk, went well, but the societal risk was completely, could not be understood. And here you can see that this is a typical, I took from the internet, it's not related to anything, of how an FN Dutch curve looks like. You have, and this is applicability, above it, this is not applicable, this is the applicability region, this is broadly applicable or acceptable, I don't know. So this is the acceptance line, and you are not allowed to cross it ever. So you can see in this demonstration that the blue one and the red one cross the acceptance line, so these processes are not applicable, and you can only do the green one and the yellow. I think I see the colors correctly. So this kind of graph became some sort of mystics to all the people that were looking at it. It was, we are above the line or below the line, without any knowledge of what you can do to take this one to the acceptance zone. Because it was not related to, this line are not related to anything. They don't have any geographic interpretation. And it was very hard to understand. And it took about a decade. And this, all the impact of the TNO study were vanished. By today, they are not considered anymore. So that was, I think that the impact was even worse, because from that time, the issue of qualitative risk assessment was completely, I don't want to say forbidden, but was rejected all the time by the Israeli authorities, because they didn't understand the TNO, the TNO one, and they didn't have the capabilities of issuing other methods, like let's say the one that is used in the UK, now in France, or in many other countries all over the world. So that was the issue that killed the QRA in Israel. By that time, after they decided, the authorities, in this sense also the Ministry of Environmental Protection, to do some sort of risk management planning, meaning that to put the responsibility of handling and managing the risks on the users, on the facilities, rather than the country, which is a very good idea and of course a correct one. And after some sort of work, they decided to use the Californian version of the RMP. RMP is the one that is used in the United States, made by the EPA, and very popular in the United, not popular, required by in the United States, and also adopted here. And it was only relevant to substances that are regulated, like ammonia, and processes that are regulated, like storage and handling of ammonia. It also concerns with the quantities that you are used. And you can use three levels of risk management. It means that it was proportional to the risk. However, that it was under the responsibility of the facility was a problem. Why? Because the Israeli authorities, by nature, do not trust the facilities, or the plants, and let's say the citizens. So if you don't trust that they are doing the right job, then you cannot put the responsibility on them. You have to put a lot of manpower to check that they are doing right. And then even if a plant has made a risk management plan according to the requirements, the ministry didn't have enough manpower or skills to check it, because a risk management plan is not like a risk survey that you get a pamphlet. It's a huge dossier with a lot of information that you have to be very familiar with the exact process that you want to check. It's not that I learned chemical engineering so I can understand what happens in an ammonia plant. This is not enough. You have to be familiar and know what is doing and what is going in ammonia plants that they didn't have. And it also had to be backed up with very good regulation and codes and checklist behind it. It was not the case in any part in the Israeli legislation. The Israeli legislation is poor. In that sense, it adopts some of the international legislations, but not related to chemical industry, or maybe only in few cases. So they did one, and they said that they want to do it by themselves, the ministry, and again, it was a very good idea to do a mechanical integrity, meaning to develop on their own a code of let's say good practice in cooling plants that are using ammonia as the coolant. And they did this, and it was again another problem, which is that Israel is we must say, as our colleagues just said, we only a part of a small city in India. So we don't have enough companies, design companies that have the knowledge or skills to do this course. There are only, let's say, I can think of three, four, maybe five companies. One of them is the largest, and that was the one that won the tender to make the code. So that's immediately a conflict of interest that you cannot find any way of breaking this conflict. And as I said at the bottom, no Chinese wall could block the conflict of interest between the company that developed, the company that the design, and the company that do the code and then have to audit. Because eventually it was the same one that did all of this. Develop, design, check, and audit. So this is not also not practical way. So in 211, the MOEP decided that planning should be done according to a different approach. In this approach, they decided that safety distances between hazardous plants and the public receptors will be done according to calculations of some sort of scenarios that will be put in Aloha software, and you get distances. These distances with the predetermined scenarios will give the appropriate separation distances. For ammonia case, there are at least five major drawbacks for using this methodology. And unfortunately, they cover everything. The substance, the software used, the reference scenario, the impact assessment, and the protection layers. Firstly, the substance, ammonia, is lighter than air. That's fact of physics. And I heard that yesterday there were also debates about if it can become, in certain conditions, become heavier. Okay. But again, it's lighter than air in most cases, most of the time. And it mostly stored at ambient temperature under pressure. Hence, on tack rupture, it flashes. That's also something that happens with ammonia, and the same applies with LPG, LNG, chlorine. Ammonia vapors form aqueous ammonia hydroxide in contact with water, meaning that even in seawater or in water and in humidity, in water vapors. So ammonia is very complex, and you cannot do risk assessment without taking this complexity into account. Then Aloha was chosen as the software. Aloha is very easy to use. It's public domain. It doesn't cost any money. Anyone can take it, load it, and use it for calculations. And it's the best, and I really mean it, it's the best package for first responders. But when it comes to ammonia, it cannot model lighter than air gases. It doesn't know how to do flash simulation. It cannot model boiling of supercooled liquid. Ammonia is getting cooled more than and less than the boiling point when it spills over. It cannot take into account the water and the ammonia equilibrium. And therefore, it's the worst package that can be used to model ammonia. So if you have bad models, of course, you have bad results. The reference scenario was also a problem. The reference scenario was something that was, as it called, operational fault or failure, not catastrophic failure. But you cannot ignore the catastrophic failure when you are going to do planning concerning hazardous chemical incidents, because they're always on the table. When you go to a planning committee, there are 8 members in the committee and more other that stakeholders that are joining the planning committee, and they are always going to raise this issue. Moreover, the civil defense uses the worst case scenario for its protection measures. Earthquakes use the worst case scenarios, not the operational and operational scenario. And the public media also talks about missiles and mines and bombs and everything, which are the worst case scenarios. They are not talking about, no one is speaking about operational scenarios. Therefore, when you do separation distance distances according to operational scenarios, they are going to be attacked immediately, not by the experts like us or by the plans, but by the public, the civil defense, and everyone else in the that is relevant. Just to say that we talked about hostile attacks, so I'll skip it. Okay, the impact also was measured for ammonia. It's irrelevant. It was measured by PAC values. PAC values are for 1 hour exposure, which is good for most of the continuous sources. Ammonia, in many, many aspects, does not form continuous releases. It may, of course, but these are not the normal operational incidents. And when you see tank ruptures, of course, cannot measured by this kind of continuous models. Spillover water, short-term operational faults like loading and unloading, and so on. And the last one, the protection layers, are also taken to be only passive when you calculate the safety distances. And again, in ammonia case, it doesn't give you any credit for loading and unloading ammonia, which is a manned operation. Then a man can, of course, do something when you get a leak. Use of detector in conjunction with shutoff valves, which is an automatic system, is not credited for separation distances. And use of detectors to monitor the incidents and actuate reduction measures like sprinklers or something are also not detected. In some cases, you can do it, but it requires that you take the worst case scenario instead of the operational scenario. Okay, so all these flows cause that in any case that ammonia was brought into conflict in Israel, it was a debate that took a lot of time, a lot of efforts, that ended up with only gigantic protection measures, or that the ammonia was removed and discarded, the ammonia plant, I mean. So, I think if anyone wants to do something about this, then a new approach for risk assessment should be made that takes into account, it should be consistent, it should be widely acceptable, meaning taking all scenarios into account, it should be robust, and the main issue, it should be risk-oriented. Thank you very much.